Welcome to Successful Living with Bill Napick. Every week we talk about success and everything that goes along with it. You'll learn the principles of success, how to achieve success, and learn to overcome challenges that may be getting in the way of success in your life. You'll hear from Bill Napick, a radio personality and business development expert, along with insight from special guests. If you're ready to find your path to success or take the success you're enjoying to the next level, stay tuned. Successful Living with Bill Napick is on right now.
And welcome to the show, Successful Living with Bill Napick. I am Bill Napick, and we have a very special guest, Tess Gerritsen. She is an internationally known best-selling author. She's retired from the medical community, and we are so glad to have her. She's written great books. I discovered her over the Thanksgiving holidays. I've had the book around, and I rediscovered it, and now here she is. Tess, welcome to the show.
I'm glad to be here. Good to talk to you.
First of all, you do have a new book out. Tell people about your new book, if you would.
Playing with Fire is a standalone book about a mysterious piece of music. A violinist from Boston picks up a piece of music in Rome in an antique store. Every time she plays it, it makes her three-year-old daughter go crazy and violent. So she has to find out what the history of this music is because she thinks it's haunted.
Oh, my goodness. Boy, just what you said there, antique shop in Rome and music. And even scary stuff. Boy, right there you have all the elements, and I guess that was the idea that started the book.
Yeah, you know, it's funny where ideas come from. You just never know when something's going to strike you, but when it does and you feel it in your gut, you know that's the next story you have to tell.
Indeed. I think a lot of us and people listening think, wow, I'd like to write a book sometime, but it's not that easy. You've been writing books for how many years?
It's been almost 30 years now, and I've written 26 books.
Oh, my goodness. And the book that I picked up to discover you was called The Apprentice, and that was the second in your Rizzoli and Isles series, right?
Yes, it was. And the funny thing is about the Rizzoli and Isles series is that I never planned a series. It started off with a book called The Surgeon, which was supposed to be a one-off. But sometimes characters linger with you. They won't leave you alone, and you realize you want to write another book about them, and eventually it turns into a series of books about the same characters.
Well, and that's giving people what they want and certainly finding out. As an author, how do you find out? How do you get the feedback? Certainly book sales, if it sells, you know they like it. But what other ways do you get feedback about the work that you put out?
Well, you know, as a writer, the first feedback you're going to get is, of course, from your editor or your agent. And that's where I usually first get it. You know, I send it in, and next thing I know, I hear from my agent. She says she loves it, or she says it could use some work. And that's the first thing. After that, because of the Internet, you get emails, you get Amazon reviews, you get Goodreads reviews. There's a lot of ways to get feedback these days.
And that's interesting. On your email address, so you're hearing from readers probably all the time, going back to all your books, and I guess you have to go back and remember, oh, yeah, that's right, I did that on that one 20 years ago, right?
It's hard to remember, though. You know, think back about, well, what did you do 25 years ago? You know, this paper that you turned in, do you remember what you said? Of course you don't remember. So I very often have to respond to questions by going back and looking at the book again.
Well, there you are. And I'm sure you have all the books. That's what's nice. Now, the book Playing with Fire, interesting premise, but also you have a musical element to that. Let's talk a little bit more about that.
Yeah, you know, when I grew up as a kid, I learned how to play the piano and the violin. So music has always been a part of my life, but I've never written a story having to do so powerfully with music. This book happened because I was in Venice for my birthday, and I had a nightmare. Mm. I dreamt I was playing my violin, and there was a baby sitting next to me, and the baby suddenly turned into a monster. That's how the story got, you know, came to be. I woke up and I thought, well, this is the story. It's about the power of music to awaken evil or to transmit evil. How do I turn that into a book? And that's eventually what Playing with Fire came from. It was about what is it like to be a musician, how musicians have their own brotherhood, and how we can communicate with each other even across the centuries through a piece of music. And while I was writing the book, I had another dream, and I dreamt the melody of this mysterious piece that appears in the book. So I composed the music as well, and it has been recorded by a concert violinist.
And I want to tell everyone, too, they can hear that melody on your website, right, Tess?
Yeah, you can hear a one-minute sample of it. The entire recording is 7 minutes, and it is available on iTunes and on Amazon.
And what is the name of the piece?
The piece is called Incendio, and it's Italian for fire.
That is fascinating. And your website also has such great information and has all the books. And as I think about your website, one of the things, as the books are there, are presented there, and I guess it's super important as an author, the cover of the book has to look just right, because sometimes, at least as a consumer of books, I look at that cover and that may draw me to pick it up or not pick it up.
Yeah, I take no credit for the covers, because I have nothing to do with the design. All I can do is suggest to my publisher various images that may come about, but they get the credit for those eye-catching designs.
Well, they are beautiful and they are eye-catching. Now, let's go back to that idea, the power of the idea, because it's so important no matter what people do. An idea can be so valuable, and we get ideas in our head all the time, but not everybody can take that idea and write a book or a piece of music. How do you develop or nurture that idea or take it to be something, a creation?
Well, I think it's really important for us to always remember where ideas come from. How do they pop up into our heads? And I firmly believe it has to do with how engaged we are with the outside world. A lot of ideas I get come from reading the newspapers. I read about 3 newspapers a day, and so I'm always getting these stories from everywhere in the world. And I make it a point, and I know people laugh, I always read the National Enquirer, because I feel as if the stories that are in the National Enquirer are things that are of interest to people around the world. I also have a background in science, so I keep up with science. I listen to conversations. I travel a lot. And all these things are sort of fertilizing your mind. They're bringing these little facts that may suddenly make a left turn in your brain, and you think, well, what if I use this tool for a completely different purpose? So ideas really spring from the fact that we should be constantly filling our heads with excess information, random information. You just never know when it will become handy.
And ideas are so valuable. How do you harness this? Do you write down the ideas as you get them, Tess, or do you have a notebook, or how does that work? And then how do you know where to use them?
Well, for me, the importance of an idea is whether or not it evokes an emotion. Because when I write, I don't want to write just about dry facts. I want to write about something that gives me that what I call the punch in the gut, where you go, whoa, what happens next? If an idea is emotionally powerful enough, I don't have to write it down. I will carry it around in my head, and I won't be able to get rid of it. But for those people who have, who are bombarded with ideas, yeah, it helps to have a notebook, and maybe you write down all the 10 ideas you had that day, and maybe a month from now, suddenly one of those ideas will set off a light bulb in your head. You'll think, oh, now I know how to use it. It's helpful to have a notebook.
Well,
but I will say that the ones that are the most powerful ideas will just stick with you.
And then I guess they stay with you and you develop them from there.
Yeah, and sometimes it takes a number of years to know how to develop them. As an example, I was an anthropology major in college, so I loved especially Egyptology and mummies. And for many years, I wanted to write a book having to do with Egyptian mummies, but I didn't know what that story was. And it wasn't until a couple decades later that it came to me how I could use this interest of mine. And I find that's true often, that I will nurture an interest for a number of years before I suddenly know how to use it in a book. So just, keep yourself curious. Writers as a group, it's my impression, tend to be quite curious people. We are interested in a lot of different topics, and those topics eventually end up in our stories.
Well, one of the things I love about the medical knowledge that you bring forth, and even as you're talking about anthropology, the medical knowledge, it makes it so real, and it does bring that emotion. As I've read now 2.5 of your books, I'm halfway through with a book called The Sinner, but as you describe the medical things And the knowledge of the human body and the forensic components that go into it, it just makes it captivating.
And, you know, that's tremendously helped by the fact I did practice as a doctor, and, you know, I know my medicine, but I have always had this, I think, this sort of dark streak in me where I've always been interested in the creepy side of medicine and biology. And if something, you know, something kind of, you know, gives me a little shiver, I will think about that and consider it for a long time. As an example, and I don't know where you are in the book, The Sinner, but I will reveal a bit of a spoiler here in that it has a great deal to do with the disease leprosy. Mm. Now, when I was practicing medicine in Hawaii, we saw a number of patients with Hansen's disease, otherwise known as leprosy. It's such a fascinating disease, not only because of the way it changes the human body. I mean, how horrifying it can be to, you know, to lose your nose and lose your fingers with this disease, but also because of its history, very ancient history. And I had always thought one of these days I'm going to write a story about leprosy, but, you know, it took me almost 20 years to come up with the plot. Another example, when I was in medical school, I remember hearing about a tribe in New Guinea called the Foray tribe, who they were all getting mad cow disease. And the question is, why were they getting mad cow disease? It was because they were eating their dead relatives. Mm. So they were getting mad people disease because they were eating people's brains and spreading this virus. Or sort of a virus we thought of at the time. It turns out it's the same misshapen protein that's causing this mad cow disease. So I thought, well, I want to use this in a story somehow. And it took me about 2 decades to figure out where that was going to come into the story.
And that's fascinating. Now, let's say you're in the process of any given book. Now, I saw in one of the interviews that I saw at YouTube, and you said that you don't, I don't know if you said you don't have a complete outline, but it sounds like you're on an adventure, as the reader is, that when you go forth with your idea and develop the book, that you don't always know where it's going to end. I think that's fascinating. How do you do that?
Important part of creativity is not to be rigid, to be willing to say midway through the story, oh, this isn't working, but I see another way to make this work. So that's really how I approach my book writing, is I start off with, I think I know who the bad guy is, and let's work towards that. And then halfway through the story, everything changes on me. But I am flexible enough to let the story go where it wants to go. And this would drive a lot of people crazy if they were writing this way, where they don't have a roadmap. But I'm so used to working without a roadmap that I don't know how to do it any other way. Writers will put themselves into 2 categories. One of them is the planners, or we call them those the plotters, and then the others who are called the pantsers, who write seat of the pants, where they figure it out as they go along. I'm definitely in that second category.
Well, and it's certainly working, no question about it. But it also makes me think, and I can't give an example, but throughout any given book, and I think it was the Mephisto Club that I read, and that is, you put things forth in the very beginning, like you're planting the seeds, and then later, 3/4 through the book, you find out what that was all about. So as a writer, is that a good way to say it, that the writer along the way, you are planting seeds for the reader to discover, and in your case, even for yourself to discover down the road?
Well, I have 2 secrets to reveal there. One of them is, you know, the prologues that you see where you think the seeds are being planted, very often those are the last scenes I ever write, because after I finish the book, I think, oh, now I know what it's all about. I better put a clue at the beginning. So the first scene in the book that you read may be the last scene, in fact, that I wrote. The second thing is that I often, you know, the trick with mystery readers is that they're really smart, so you're always trying to fool them, and you're always trying to, you want to be fair with them. You want to give them the chance to solve it themselves. And in order to do that, you have to give them enough clues. So those people who read the book slowly and pay attention, I would assume many of them are going to be able to figure out what the solution to the mystery is. But only the smart ones. And there are clues. There are definitely clues that I plant early on. And there's also a lot of misdirection. So I would say maybe 1/3 of my readers have guessed the bad guy by the time they get to the end.
Kind of like when you talk about misdirection, that's like a magician.
Yeah, in many ways it is like a magician. It's sleight of hand. You're saying, pay attention to this hand, and when the other hand is actually doing all the dirty work.
Well, it sounds like you are enabling people to really enjoy themselves when they read your books. And I go back to what I said at the beginning, during a day off or time, a few hours, boy, around the holiday seasons and so forth, it's great to have a time off and to enjoy yourself with a great book. And as you tell me about this, Tess, there's no doubt you love what you do. What is it you love about being a writer?
Well, I love the chance to explore topics that I'm curious about. I mean, in real depth. So over the course of 26 books, let me think, I have written a book about what it's like to be an astronaut aboard the International Space Station. I wrote a book called Gravity and spent 2 years doing the research, went to NASA, there I was at Johnson Space Center, and I was in Florida, just exploring what it's like to be in microgravity and what it's like to be for months up in the International Space Station. So that was my chance to do my sort of inner space geek. I did a book on Egyptian mummification. The book is called The Keepsake, and you will learn, if you read that book, how to mummify a human body.
You'll learn
how to make a bog body as well, but I mean, just kind of weird, creepy stuff. So, yeah, it's every book is a chance to explore a new topic.
That is so awesome. And I want to remind everybody, the website is so good, as I mentioned, Tess. Again, it is TessGerritsen.com. GERRITSEN. And of course, put Tess on front of that. Tess, it's so exciting to talk to you. I'm really enjoying the interview. Now, also, the characters that you've written about, Rizzoli and Isles, it inspired a TV show called Rizzoli and Isles. Let's tell people about that. How did that happen?
I got a call from a television producer, about 7 years ago saying, I love your girls and I think they belong on television. It turned out he'd been reading the book. So it became a TV show on TNT. It's now going into its seventh season, and it stars Angie Harmon as Jane Rizzoli and Sasha Alexander as Dr. Maura Isles. And it's a really big success, and it's now in syndication.
That has to be very exciting for you to know that at one time these were just ideas in your mind, and you wrote the books, you did the research, created fascinating characters, and now someone has portrayed them on TV, right?
Yeah, and I think what they were excited by, and I think what the viewership has connected to, is the idea of two women professionals who are really good at what they do, who are also good friends. That at the time it premiered, there was nothing else like it on television. It was sort of the Cagney and Lacey of the 21st century.
And of course, people can get the show. They can buy the copies on iTunes, and that's great. There's 6 seasons there available. I think last night I saw. So you can get it there. Watch it on TNT. And also, let's go back to Playing with Fire, Tess. That is such a great book. That after I finish The Sinner, I'm going to break from Rizzoli and Isles and go to Playing with Fire. Tell us a little bit more about that.
There's something about Playing with Fire that was, I think, almost came to me in a supernatural way, in that I dreamt the plot and then I dreamt the music. But I think what it really touches is what it's like to be a musician who knows a violin, how close musicians are to their violins, and how they almost we're almost closer to our instruments than we are to our spouses. Mm. So when I wrote the music in Cendio, an international violinist named Suzanne Howe recorded it, strangely enough, I found out that she recorded it on a 200-year-old violin made in Cremona, which is exactly how I described the violin that was in the story, a 200-year-old violin made in Cremona. There were all these weird parallels that happened that sort of drew in not only the music and the story, but also a lot of the history, because the history harkens back to World War II in Venice and the Italian Jews who were deported to death camps there. And since I've been on book tour, I've been hearing from so many survivors from that era, including one elderly gentleman who said he was a survivor from Vienna, and the one thing he remembers is that the Nazis took his violin, and he forever mourns the loss of that violin. So I think it touches on a great deal more than just the thriller aspect, but also about how all musicians around the world are, in a way, the same family.
Indeed, that is so fascinating and touching so many points there. I can't wait to read it. I know people listening are thinking the same thing. Now, you are so busy. very successful writing, doing all those things. But give us an idea. You are also married. You have children. How do you handle the balance? Where do you find balance?
That is a real tough topic because I think a lot of writers have that problem. And luckily, my children grew up and they're, you know, they're young men now and they have their own kids. But while they were young, the balance was that always took, you know, your children always take precedence. And that's what I would do. I would wait until the school bus came and pick them up for school, and that's when I would start writing. And then when the school bus delivered them at the end of the day, that's when I stopped writing. But even after your children are gone and, you know, off and doing their own lives, the trouble is still balance. And it's really important for writers to always live a full life because that's where our stories come from. So I travel a lot. I make a point of being a tourist. I mean, in fact, I consider myself a lifelong tourist. And I play music and I garden. So just things to keep the soul always fed.
Indeed. And many people may not know, I also play the piano and organ, and I love music. There is such a connection. It is so enriching to all our lives. Tess, also, hearing from the fans, what do they ask you the most?
It's funny. Most of the questions have to do with Maura Iles' love life. They want to know who she's going to end up with. Now, you probably haven't reached that point in the series, but Maura has an affair with a Catholic priest, which turns out to be a very unhappy thing for both of them. But, you know, years later, she's still in love with him. So all my readers want to know, well, what happens between her and the priest? And the answer is, I don't know. I haven't gotten there yet.
Well, that is terrific. Also, one of the things, you live in Maine. That seems like a great place for inspiration. Beautiful.
Yeah, we
there.
Have more writers per capita in this state than any state in the country. That's what I'm told by a chamber of commerce. I think it's the beauty, it's the changing seasons, and it's the fact we have very long winters when there's nothing you can do but stay inside and write.
Well, now, if anyone's listening there that is an aspiring author, what would you give them a word of advice?
Number one is, if you're young and you want to know what to write about, live a life. You know, live your life. Learn what it's like to fall in love, to have a job, to have kids, to have a fight with your mother. I mean, these are all things that go into your stories. Number two, make sure the idea that starts your book is something that evokes some very powerful emotion in you, something that you really feel deeply. And the third is, I would say, stick with the story. Don't stop to edit. Just keep on writing until you finish the first draft. Because way too many aspiring writers get partway through the first draft and then they get discouraged and they stop. And I just say, keep on all the way till the end. You don't know what you're going to end up until you write the end.
That is so great. Tess, we are so happy that you have been on our show today. Ladies and gentlemen, Tess Gerritsen, best-selling author, great person. And Tess, thank you so much. What else should people know?
Yes, just visit my website at tessgerritsen.com to hear all the latest. And, oh, one other thing, I'm making a horror film, which we're going into production in March. So if you hear about a movie next fall called Island Zero, that's the one I wrote.
Well, we can't wait. Thank you so much, Tess.
Thank you.
Successful Living with Bill Napick, and thank you for listening. We'll see you next week.